What this video is going to be is a demonstration of a calculation for the geodesic motion of a test particle in the spacetime, and I will show that when that test particle is the ship having initially zero velocity with respect to these coordinates, that when the when beta goes to 1, its speed does arbitrarily approach the speed of light. Thus, the utility in having this kind of a ship would be that instead of using Newtonian action-reaction rockets or special relativistic rockets or standard technologies of this type in order to boost one's speed, one would use gravitation itself to travel from one location to another. As long as the gradient of F is not great, as it was in my model, but as it wouldn't be in practice, you would not feel any of these kinds of acceleration. You would not be pushed about by anything. You would just fall weightless up to whatever speed you want to take the ship. That would be the utility in having this kind of a warp drive. So that's why I'm investigating this particular kind of space-time. So in order to do the geodesic calculation, I could just take the geodesic equation and try to solve that directly, but the geodesic equation would take me through a bunch of non-linear second-order differential equations in four coordinates, which turns out to be a big mess. So I'm not going to do it that way. I'm going to use killing vectors to find the geodesic behavior of the test particle. The first thing that I'm going to do is transform the coordinates to another set of coordinates, UV coordinates, in which a obvious killing vector manifests. So I do this UV coordinate transformation and find this bottom equation for ds squared in the UV coordinates, where h in this set of coordinates is a function of x, y, and u instead of x, y, and z minus ct. Since h, and in fact the metric read off of this line element, does not in any way depend on v, you know that there is an isometry in the metric with respect to v, that there is a killing vector in the v direction. So the next thing I do is write out that killing vector, and I take the zeroth coordinate to be the v coordinate when I write that out. Killing vectors have a property that for a rank 1 killing vector, for example, the contraction of the metric with the killing vector and the 4 vector velocity gives you a constant of the motion. So this is the means that I'm going to use to find the geodesic for the ship. So I'm going to call that constant kc over the square root of 2. And I just call it that so that I can get rid of some 2's that appear in the equation of motion. And when you write out u in terms of what it was in terms of ct and z, you get dct d tau minus dz d tau equals a constant. And I recognized left part of this as components of the velocity 4 vector, and the velocity 4 vector is directly related to the momentum 4 vector. So I can write that constant from that recognition as E minus pzc over mc squared, where E is the time element of the momentum 4 vector, pz is the z element of the momentum 4 vector, and mc squared, as per the definition that I use for mass, is an invariant. It does not change with respect to position within the gravitational field, nor with speed. It's given by the full contraction of a momentum 4 vector, so the mass is not m squared equals e squared minus p squared like in special relativity, but actually has this extra term h that shows up in the calculation of the relationship between the energy, momentum, and the mass. So from here what I do is I take the line element, actually, and divide through by ds squared, and use it to describe the path of the test particle so that ds becomes dc tau, the proper time for the test particle. Once I've done that, I have these du d tau terms, which I can switch out for that constant from the relationship that I found using the killing vector. So the line element itself then gives you an equation of motion in terms of dv d tau and dx d tau and dy d tau. The next thing I do then is switch out what v was in terms of ct and z, and I come up with an equation of motion. And I take that and take the result in terms of ct and dz d tau from the that I got from the killing vector, and replace one at a time into that long equation to get one of them, one equation in terms of dct d tau, no dz d tau, and a second equation in terms of dz d tau and no dct d tau. That gives me two equations of motion. The first one is going to result in the time dilation of the test particle, and the second equation is going to give me the equation of motion for the test particle. The next thing that I do, then these two equations were general for whatever initial energy and momentum your test particle has, but the next thing that I'm going to do is consider that the test particle is the ship, and say that the ship is initially at zero velocity with respect to these x, y, and z and ct coordinates, in which case the constant k is equal to 1. If you go back and look at what that was in terms of energy and momentum, you'll see that that's 1. And I'm not going to have the ship moving in the y or x directions, so those two equations greatly simplify down to something that can easily be solved for time dilation and for dz d tau. So first I solve the first one for the time dilation and find that dt d tau is equal to 2 minus h over 2, and I can then replace h in terms of the equation relating it to beta f, as I define beta f. And that final result is the equation for time dilation for the ship as the warp overtakes it. And notice that as beta f goes to 1, the time for the ship becomes infinitely dilated. So time slows to a top slows to a stop as beta f goes to 1 for the occupants of the ship. The second thing that I do is solve the next equation for dz d tau and find that dz d tau is minus h over 2. However, we really want that in terms of our remote coordinate t instead of the ship coordinate time tau, so that we know how fast that it's moving with respect to, for example, Earth-based coordinates. So I use the chain rule and that equation that we just got for the time dilation and make that replacement, find that dz dt is equal to minus h over 2 minus h, replace what h was in terms of f, and we finally get the equation of motion for the ship as it's moving with speed dz dt with respect to these coordinates. And so we note then that as beta f goes to 1, indeed that expression does reduce to dz dt equals c, so you can use the space-time to get the ship arbitrarily close to the speed of light.